Welcome back. We're here at Classic Talk with Bing and Dennis. Today we're having a great time speaking with Rachel Willis Sørensen. Before the break, we were talking about being healthy and the effect of losing weight on your voice. So your experience has been what with that?
Well, it's pretty funny, actually. I'm such a rebel, I guess. But I was asked, I always thought that, so I have lost 70 pounds. I'm still on my journey, but I've lost 70 pounds. And I always thought that being 70 pounds heavier than this, I was saved from being asked to do things I didn't want to do on stage. But then it didn't work. Someone actually asked me to do something nude, and I was uncomfortable with it. And I didn't ever have to say I was uncomfortable with it because my manager told them, she's a bigger girl, she's not going to want to do that. And I was like, that's not why. I don't want to do it because it's tasteless. I was like wanting to be in this position. I realized it was compromising my freedom. I couldn't make as many artistic choices. And I always thought it was some sort of protection, but ultimately I wanted to have more freedom than to be protected from that. It's just funny. So then that was the greatest motivator for losing weight. And I found a health coach and I started doing like a low carb with this health coach, a specific program. And yeah, I found that it really helped my singing. And honestly, I wasn't doing it for my career. It wasn't like trying to improve the number of roles I could do, but that is a really nice side effect, I would say, that now I'm being considered for things maybe I would have been overlooked for in the past. But also just feeling generally better in the world, like having a higher level of health, attaining a higher degree of health, bounding down the street. I mean, this morning I ran on a treadmill and I haven't run for a while. I mean, I have three little children. It's hard to carve out any time to exercise, but I thought, oh, I'm going to go to the gym this morning. And I was like, I haven't run in really long time. I used to run before I had children. It's just, anyway. And I ran 3 miles, like just
wow.
Out the gate. You know, I had a much lower expectation, but I think my body is so much happier at this 70 pounds lighter. It's much easier in the world. I don't get nearly as winded. I mean, which is funny because I never considered myself unhealthy before, but now I know like there's less pressure on my joints. It's just, it's a more pleasant experience at this weight, I will tell you.
Good for you.
Thank you. Yeah.
That's great. So it has affected which roles you see yourself singing or not.
Yeah, I mean, that's an interesting, well put. I mean, it's interesting the way you put that. The roles I see myself doing. I think I'm just, maybe I would have been overlooked for roles from the outside that I always wanted to do. For example, I've now been given the opportunity to sing Traviata. I mean, what a dream. I thought I must be dreaming when they told me they wanted me to do that. I thought, of course, I'm doing this. Might be the only time. Maybe it's one of many times. We'll see. There are plenty of Violettas in the world. But that's just something I've always really loved, that character, and I would love to, you know, wrap my voice around her and see how it feels. So that's something I'm very excited about. And it's interesting, but a lot of people hear you with their eyes, you know? And if you're able to present in a glamorous, beautiful way, I think people tend to believe better things about your singing. I don't know, it's a little sad maybe, but that's, in my experience, kind of the case.
Speaking of Traviata and Verdi, you recently sang Vespri, right?
Such a game changer, yeah.
Yes, and tell us about it. Why was it a game changer?
Well, I wanted to sing Verdi, and my manager was looking for an opportunity, and then he called me one morning. I was in New York, and he said, I'm in Paris. Do you want to sing Hélène in Vêpres Siciliennes? And I was like, oh, and rehearsals start in 1 week. No, I said, oh, thank you. No, I don't hate myself enough to show up completely unprepared. I mean, how much can you prepare in 1 week, right? And also I misunderstood that it was in Paris because he was in Paris, but actually it was in Munich. So for some reason I was like, well, like you can't debut at the Paris Opera with 1 week preparation in French.
In French.
No. But
in Munich,
I mean, in Munich, plus since it was a new production, it was a long rehearsal period and they had a lot of support and they were happy to accept me, even though they knew I had barely heard of the project. And so I said, okay, let's do this. I mean, I listened to the piece, the aria from the fourth act, Amie le coeur d'Hélène. I just listened to many recordings of it on Apple Music, and I was like, oh my gosh, I would die to sing this. So beautiful.
Let's take a listen.
Oh, you and you have it. Yes. All queued up.
Mm-hmm. So beautiful. Tell us, you need to, after watching that, you need to tell us a little bit of background for it.
Yeah, so Hélène is the last surviving aristocrat from Sicily. Her family's been murdered by the French. She has a friend, Henri, who is supposed to avenge her brother by murdering Guy de Montfort, the captain of the French army, and it turns out that's his father. And when he finds this out, he thwarts her assassination attempt. So she hates him, and she's like, "You betrayed me." And then he says, "I gave up my honor because he's my father." And then she sings, "Okay, fine, I forgive you." This aria. "Well, I guess I can't remain angry and resentful toward you because he's your father, after all." And so she says, "Also, I love you. It turns out in all of this, I fell in love with you." It's a great piece.
Beautifully sung.
Thank you. Oh, what a joy.
What other Verdi do you see in the future?
I have on the books Don Carlo, Elisabetta, and like I said, Traviata. Those are the only two, but I am in hot pursuit of an Otello. I would really love to sing that. Maybe Amelia Grimaldi. And I mean, we'll see. There's so much, right? There's so much. I don't want to jinx it, but I'm thrilled for this little foray into Verdi. It's beautiful music and something I always wanted to do.
On a much lighter note, this past year you had the honor, I can only say honor, of singing at a very famous person's 70th birthday.
Yeah.
Prince
that's
Charles.
True. I thought it was a practical joke when I was called about it. I was like, "Oh, ha ha." But they meant it, and it was at Buckingham Palace. Actually, I went to Buckingham Palace and sang for Prince Charles. It was really lovely. With Philharmonia Orchestra, Esa-Pekka Salonen conducted in the four last songs.
All four?
No, we only did the last two, which I said, "Why aren't we doing all four?" And they said, "Oh, it's a limited program. We can't expect people to have the attention span." And I thought, "Oh, well, that's insulting to them and me." But then, beautifully, as soon as it was done, Prince Charles spoke to the 200 invited guests, and he said, "My only regret is that we didn't hear all four of the last songs."
Really?
He really said that. I know. I could be making it up, but I swear, I was there. Pinch me. It happened.
Do you feel like you start from the top?
I mean, I skipped a big section. I don't know. It feels like there's this grueling, clawing element where you have to, I don't know. I remember being told when I was a young artist, "You'll probably be a cover for 10 years. You'll probably cover at the Met. It's the best thing you can hope to do is cover at the Met for 10 years. And then you'll be given compromarial roles. And then you'll be..." And I was like, "Oh, I don't want to do that." I mean, lots of people do that. There's nothing wrong with that, of course. And it's a great way to make a living. But I just really, I want to perform, you know? I'm dying to perform. And just whatever that thing is in here that is just bursting out of me, I really wanted to get it out there. And so I got really lucky and skipped some of that. I don't think it's fair. I mean, but, I don't really know why. I think it's sort of disproportionate fortune, but I'm so happy.
Meant to be.
Yeah, it was fate.
Many singers go through a period, you have to call it a crisis, a vocal crisis.
Yeah.
Anything like that ever happened to you? Or?
I mean, so to speak, actually. I mean, I was just singing heavier and heavier rep every season. And a couple of seasons ago, I sang Fidelio, Leonora, for the first time and maybe the last time. No, I mean, it went okay, actually. I had to work so hard with my teacher to get it to where I didn't feel like I was going to bleed out the mouth by the end. I mean, it was so screamy. Beethoven is, in my opinion, not a very vocal... He's not kind to the voice.
Do you do the Ninth Symphony?
I do so many times, and I do love it. But those four lines are very challenging for this.
Okay. Back to Fidelio.
Anyway, and I remember in that season, I just started to struggle in the high. I was really singing this heavy rep, and I just started to struggle a little bit in the high, and I thought, I don't know if I'm on the right path. I think there were a lot of things. I had baby twins. Okay, that's relevant. There was no sleeping happening. And now they're sleeping, and that makes a huge difference. But like I said, also in the weight loss, when I went back and had a weekly voice lesson, I really re-examined my technique. And, you know, no, I think, I will say that I think more when I'm singing about technique, about support rather, than I ever have before. And that makes a big difference. I think there was like maybe too much of it was just doing and hoping for the best before. And now I have to be very conscious about my support, which makes a big difference. And maybe has avoided a bigger vocal crisis. I mean, I say that, watch in 5 years, maybe I'll fall apart again, we'll see. But luckily I have a good support structure and hopefully we'll be able to overcome whatever challenges.
Were you worried about it?
I was worried about the high. I thought, why am I struggling so much on like a B? I mean, sometimes I felt like I couldn't even sing a B. But now it's much easier, and I do absurdly high vocalises just to prove that I can sometimes. Like recently I went up to a B flat above high C, you know, just because I could phonate up there, you know. Not that I would perform these notes, but so the high is back. I think we're okay.
Were you wondering the directions?
Yeah, well, I mean, like I said, I wanted to sing Verdi. I wanted to sing more lyrical repertoire because it really spoke to me. I mean, mostly, music speaks to me, mostly all of it, but I just thought, if I go down this path, if I'm only singing Wagner and heavy Strauss, like, I'm not going to be able to ever experience those other pieces, and so that didn't feel right. That didn't really sit correctly, so I'm glad I've had a shift.
Why is it such a temptation to sing?
I mean, because people make you glamorous offers, you know, sometimes a big splashy project with really important colleagues that's gonna be released on DVD and from a big house, a new production with an important director, an important conductor. You know, you wanna be a part of these things, and it's hard to say, I'm gonna turn that down with no other offer in the same period and just hope for the best. But sometimes you have to do that. I think it's, maybe I'm crazy, but maybe it would be better to, have to get another job or something to support yourself rather than screaming your way out through a piece that you probably should have avoided. I don't know. It's hard. Because people tell you this when you're very young, but then you don't really know that what it feels like. Suddenly you're in it. You have three children to support, and you have to, you know, you have to do that by whatever means necessary, and you're being told, yeah, you can do Brunhilde tomorrow, we'll pay you $20 trillion. Of course you're gonna consider it, but some things you just have to be careful and smart about. By the way, that was an imaginary project.
How old is your kid?
So I have a 5-year-old daughter and twin sons who are 3 and a half. It's a wild and crazy adventure in my house.
Is your husband also in the same field?
No, he's writing a novel. He's just finished his first novel, so he's pursuing publication at this moment. And yeah, I'm really proud of him. He does it from the road, and we travel together most of the time. So,
does he watch you or help him write?
Yeah, we trade. It's true. Like he'll come to my shows and tell me this was great, that needs work. No, he's so supportive. But also for a long time, I was his only editor. But I think this was too big a strain on the marriage, to be honest. Like I wouldn't recommend it. So now he's sort of shifting that to other people. Maybe that's a better for all of us.
How did you meet?
We were missionaries for a church in Germany in 2006. That's how we met. And then when we were done, so he served for 2 years and I served for 18 months. And when we went home, we talked on the phone and he was like, let's get married really fast. And I was like, wait. But then he's so wonderful that we just got married really quick. I don't know. It's crazy. Life works out the way it does, I guess.
Right.
I'm not sorry. And now here we waited 6 years and then we had our daughter. And then nearly 2 years later, we had twins. So that went really fast, too, like from zero to three children within 21 months. That was quite a process.
Think about more?
Oh, I don't know. I don't think so. I think three turns out to be a pretty big number of children. Also, once you've had multiples, your likelihood of having them is much higher than someone who hasn't had them. So that's something I fear, so I wouldn't really want to relive two colicky babies at once again if I could help it. That was kind of intense.
Do you still sing during the pregnancy?
I did, yeah. I did a lot of concerts with the twins.
Oh.
Actually, I have a recording of a voice lesson I had on Mimi. I sang Mimi when my daughter, so my first was about 2.5 months old. I really didn't take much time off. But I mean, I was fest in Dresden. I was home every night and have a very supportive husband, like I said, so it was possible to accomplish. But I had a voice lesson the day before I gave birth.
Wow.
And I listened to it about a year later, and I just remember being shocked. Like, it was the best singing of my life.
Is that right?
Yes, it's so great. I was so lazy. I didn't want to stand. I was like, oh, I'm just going to sit, you know, with this big belly. But I just, something about the hormones of pregnancy, the baby in there that you push against for your support, I don't know, like, I'll never be able to recreate that level of vocal technique. It was very good singing, really.
Wow.
Funny. So I did. I sang through the pregnancies. And it's funny how when you have children, sometimes people think, I mean, I did get this feedback from a lot of people. Well, now you're just a mom. Now you're just going to crap out of your career. Mm-hmm. But in my case, my gosh, I'm financially supporting the family. It's never been more important for me to be fulfilling my artistic potential, you know, and ultimately being recompensated. So, yeah, it's a funny thing. I don't know. It's a little bit of a sexist world, isn't it, when women are shamed for having children? I don't know. But I guess everyone's path, you know, you have to find your own path. And that was a very important part of mine. And still is.
I think probably most important, you still love the music.
Oh, yeah, of course. And actually, I remember when I did Operalia, you talked about it earlier, Placido talked to me afterwards and said, I'm so glad you already have a child. That's so great for your artistry. And I would agree that whatever artistic things I had to say before I had children, I can't speak for anyone else's experience, but now that I've experienced more with them, it really... I have more to say artistically. I have a much deeper well to draw from for these characters that I portray.
What about your children react to your singing?
They think that my voice sounds so sad. They think they, I don't know why, even the happiest song, and it makes them cry. They're like, oh, mommy, your voice is so sad. I don't know if it's because classical singing is kind of like, you know, you try to access the singer's formant or this element, this primal sound of the voice that is often found in crying. I don't know, they find it really sad. Hopefully they outgrow this. I don't know. I took them to see a shortened version of The Magic Flute at the Deutsche Oper in December, and that was the first time they'd been to the opera to watch a full performance, and they were so excited about it, and they loved it, and it was a really wonderful experience. I mean, they're so fortunate, right, to get to rub shoulders with other opera kids and... to see these kind of world-class performances.
Sure.
Hopefully that'll be a thing that they treasure in their lives rather than resent because they didn't get the stability of a normal 9-to-5 parent.
You never know, another singer's from your family.
I know, right? Maybe in the future they'll choose it, but it's not certainly not something we're trying to force on them.
No.
They love music the same way I do. I mean, they really respond to music, and that's an important part of our life.
You have sung at a very young age the Marschallin.
Yeah, right? I was young.
And it was not in a little theater either. It was at the Royal Opera House. Is that correct?
Yeah. Yes. And maybe this is one of those things you said, why is it so seductive to take these projects on? But I was offered to do the last three. It was the same production that came to the Met last year. But so they did it at Covent Garden in 1617. Anyway, Renee Fleming did the first five, and I was to do the last three. Maybe we had one overlap in the middle, but of a run of eight, she did five and I did three. So I got to observe Renee Fleming singing the Marschallin. I mean, I couldn't have had a better masterclass in the role than observing her do the rehearsals. And it was just such a, how could I possibly have said no to that, right? And I know I did struggle a little bit because I heard even her talk about how she did it too young and she decided to put it away for a while and then come back to it later. And I thought, oh, I'm such a fraud. I can't sing this role. You know, and honestly, I think it's the kind of thing that will hopefully develop throughout my career. But I do think that I was so moved by the piece, by the text, that what I said with it, I think, was worth hearing, even if it wasn't
plus 20
years.
Because in real life, the Marschallin is not that old.
No, in real life, she's 32, and I was 32. So I figured, hey, I'm exactly... Yeah. But I guess 32 back then is a lot older than it is now.
Right. Plus, one has the mentality today that the Marschallin must be much
65.
Older.
65. Yeah, I know. I heard someone say, it's a piece about a woman giving up her sexuality. She's entering that metamorphosis into non-woman. Someone said that. I thought, well, that's one way of looking at it. But, I mean, by then, I already had three children. I already had, you know, my little life experience to bring to it. And also, I mean, there are so many universal themes in the piece that you can relate to. You don't have to be 65. But maybe it is better, right? Well, that remains to be seen. Hopefully I'll sing that role as long as I live and maybe come back to me in 20 years and, you know, you can be the judge if it improved.
The good thing about that role also, it's not a role where you sing for 3 hours of singing in the evening. I mean, it's not a lengthy role compared to, say, singing a Brunhilde or something.
Right. I mean, it's not a vocal... it's not a vocal risk.
No.
It's very lyrical. It's written in a very generous way for the voice. In fact, of all the things I've ever sung, that felt the most conversational. Like, I just could roll out of bed and, you know, I don't know. Come ma vita, shots. It's just nothing. You just say it. You just say all the text.
With the three kids, and how do you balance your career?
Oh my gosh, so poorly. Just kidding. We, I just, you know, it is a desperate struggle, always trying to maintain the perfect balance. Luckily, I couldn't do without my husband, who just gives me whatever I need and all the time I need to work on the roles. And obviously, that's I make time for them every single day and whenever I can. And luckily, we're just most often together. So actually, this fun, crazy, unpredictable profession, you know, we work 6 days a week, but not like an 8-hour workday typically. So it kind of lends itself well to family life in a way. Once the show is open, I'll have multiple days off a week. So I'm with them. They are with both parents. My children are with both parents probably much more than is normal to be. So I don't know. How do I strike the balance?
What about when school starts? When they are school age?
So my daughter has begun kindergarten. We do it online. That is possible. Oh. We do a program called K-12, and my husband is her learning coach, and she's very quickly learned to read, and she logs in every day at the same time to see the teacher, and it's like the Jetsons. We're living in the future. Yeah. I don't know if it will last forever, but right now it's really working for us.
Mm-hmm. Right now you're in New York singing
Don Nana
and Don Giovanni. Yeah. Is this something, one of your favorite roles, or you've done a lot or not so much?
It is. I've done it more than anything else. Maybe with the exception of maybe The Countess, but I've done a lot of productions. I want to say this is my 8th. Oh. And it is so fun to always come back. And the last production I did at Covent Garden was such a different take on the story compared to every other production I've done. I feel it's hard to come back. The one at the Met is very traditional. It's just the piece. We're just telling the piece. There's not a lot of, you know, you say this, but really you mean 5 different things. And one time someone told me that Donana killed her own father. I was like, how do you figure the rest of this piece? But I mean, everyone has an idea about Donana. I think generally people don't tend to understand her very well. In my experience. But it's really wonderful to revisit the same role so many times and bring out different nuances and try to tell the story in a more profound way. It's a great pleasure.
Of all the Mozart roles you have sung, is there one that the evening just makes you the happiest or you enjoy the most?
Maybe it is actually Don Anna or Vitellia, Clemenza di Tito, but I haven't done that one as many times. But singing Don Anna is really wonderful. In a way, you get a long break. You know, there are many scenes you're not in. You don't have to hold the whole night. So it's not a huge demanding part, but she has so much power. And in my opinion, Don Giovanni, the opera revolves around 2 figures. There are 2 autonomous figures. Everyone else sort of just revolves around those 2. And one is Don Giovanni and the other is Don Anna. And so it's great to be someone with so much power in her convictions, albeit not a lot of power in her ability to make change in the world. So that's the tragic part of the character. But it's really fun to sing her. But also I love singing Fior di Ligi and singing The Countess, which I've done many times. Mozart has a lot to offer. And I am of the belief that it's very healthy for you, Mozart. It's just good for your body to be around Mozart. Good for your brain.
So your life, your career seems to be so smooth. And what can you share with the new singers, the young singers? What is the most important thing?
Oh man, the most important thing is belief in oneself and belief in one's message. If you don't have, if you are taught that what you have to say is not worth saying, then you will suffer and you won't be the artist that you should be. But everyone was born with a message inside them, and singers get to share it in this medium. And I think sometimes people work so hard to smooth all the rough edges that people get this trained out of them, this X factor, this element to them that pulled them to the thing in the first place. And it's so important that you hold on to that. The love of the art form and the joy that is found in the expression of the music, that is without question the most important element.
I think that's a wonderful place to stop with the joy of music. It's been a great pleasure for us to speak with you, Rachel.
Thank you.
Thank you for being with us. This has been Classic Talk with Bing and Dennis. Today we've had the great pleasure of speaking with Rachel Willis Sørensen.